All right. So thanks for being here. First, some query. Who knows what is the PPCI project already here in this? All right, I see 1.5. Who has ever installed Visual Studio on Windows? Okay, that's more people. Well, for those people, it might be interesting to know what this is. So my name is Wendel Bouwman. I will talk about the PPCI project. I've been developing this. So in a nutshell, what is it? It is a library for building compilers. There's language frontends, code optimization, and also architecture backend. And it's all written in Python. And so the only requirement of this compiler is Python is bigger than 3.4, I think. And minor disclaimer, this is the only warning I will give. It's alpha status, so that's done. So what is the features of this library? In it is a graph coloring register allocator. Probably may not know what it is, but it's inside a compiler. We'll come to that. Also, it's instruction selection by pattern matching is included in here. There's a command line debugger, and there's machine support for 9 different architectures included. And also, I've been playing with a C frontend, but that is still in the early phase. So maybe a little bit of history. I don't know when it was, but some time ago, more than 3 years ago. I want to write my own operating system, and I was searched for good tooling. And I was not so happy with Visual Studio. I was also not so happy with DC and Clang because of the... Clang was not there yet, but because of the installation hassle. So I decided to start looking into writing a compiler in Python. I thought, how hard can it be? Turns out more difficult than I thought, but it is still doable because it's a compiler and Python is a programming language, so it is possible. And the compiler and the compiler evolved over time into the current state. So I'm not going to give a full course of compiler design because that is a lot of information, but the basics is depicted in this diagram. So if you have a compiler, what it is, it's actually a converter. So it takes source code and spits out machine code. So how does it do that? First, it goes in a front-end. In a front-end, you have split the source into tokens and parse it, and then generate some intermediate code from it. Then you can optimize this code. And then at the end, you take this intermediate code, ER stands for intermediate representation, and you generate machine code of it. So the advantage here is that, say you want to add a new language. By using this strategy, you only have to generate a new front-end and generate the correct ER code, and all the back-ends will remain the same. So that's actually a pretty clever trick what's thought of in compiler design. And to go from ER code to machine code, there is algorithms involved to select the proper machine code instruction and also to label which register should be used at what point. So this is the basics. And for the optimization part, you see that intermediate code goes in, it's optimized, and hopefully intermediate representation goes out, which is better than what went in. And there's no golden bullet here, so it's just try this, make it better, try. Lots of different algorithms you can do here. And one is CSE, that is common sub-expression elimination. Not going into detail there. So, how about existing projects? This is an overview. Of course, you have at the bottom, you have compilers implemented in C, C++. It's GC and LVM, well known. Visual Studio should probably also be there. And then the tools which are implemented in Python. This is a far from complete overview, but I hope to make the picture clear. is for frontends there's a PyC parser, which takes source code and transforms it into an AST, just like the, I think, AST module does of Python itself. And at the far right, there is the PeachPy library, with which you can emit machine code instructions. But the connection between those two, I'm not aware of this. So that is the place where you should think of the PeachPy project. So it's implemented in Python. So on the right, you see the implementation language. All right, so now you probably know what it is. Why the hell would you do this? It's slower than the ones in C++. Yes, of course. That is the case because it is Python, it's interpreted, so it will be slower. But as I mentioned before, all people who have installed Visual Studio, they would like to do pip install, give me my compiler. And that is possible with PPCI. And also, what is the goal is to make it easier to understand and maybe modify the compiler, so that it is easily to say you have an ID for an optimization, you can try it out. And it for me personally was a great learning experience to do this. So instead of using this library, I can recommend to not use this library, but do it yourself if you want to learn something new. But it's a lot of work. So this is a little bit about the project's structure. So it's the usual Python project. There's a language directory which contains the language frontends. There's a code gen directory which contains the specific algorithms. And there's an architecture directory which contains descriptions for several architectures. And then there's test and documentation. All right. To go on. All right, let's see what we can do. Let's compile some C code. So here I have a simple example. Let's do some complex calculations, add A and B together. So I write my program here. It's demo1.c. And to compile this with the PPCI project, I've installed it. You can type PPCI CC, which stands for the C compiler. And then I can pass the flag minus C, which means only compile this stuff, and output it in demo1.og. This OG file is not a normal O file, what you expect from GCC. It is some self-made-up format. So I can get this file. It's a JSON file, so it's not a binary file, so you can also manipulate it by hand if you want to, but it contains the things that you should be in an object file. So that's fine, but we can also do minus s, which means spit out the assembly code. And then I will... So now you have the same program, but compiled to machine code. But this is now for x86 code, or x86 architecture. But let's say we want to generate MSP 430 code. Anyone know what this processor is? It's a microcontroller. All right. So now it will take the same program, and we can output this again, and you see, if you remember the previous assembly code here, it's different code for a different architecture. And what also is possible, I'll show that. So instead of emitting the assembly instructions, you can also output the intermediate representation. So that is, if you remember the previous slides, the in-between steps of the code. So here you see the intermediate representation of the C code. So say you have C code or some other code. Of course, there's also a brainfuck frontend for you available, because that's very easy to create. This front end, so that is super handy. So here you see an example of the intermediate code. Right, let's speed up. Compile it. Yes. So now we've seen the command line tools. The command line tool is made with the Python argparse module. And the command line tools wrap the high-level functions which is in the API module. So you can import the API module. And here I've loaded the same example as before, but then in as an how to say, an string IO object. So it's a file-like object. And I can now compile this this C code for the current platform. Let's inspect what the current platform is. So it's the x86 platform. You can also look at, okay, what kind of symbols are in this object. And then, thanks to a tip from Luke Campagnola, there's this nice thing that you can load an object in the currently running Python interpreter. So there's a function, load object, and you can load the code and call the calculate function on it, because if you look here, that's the function that was defined. And as you can see, let's make it somewhat more exciting. Ah, yes. So you can do this, and you have now compiled the code loaded in the process, and you can access it via some C types wrapping stuff. All right. So a small example on how, say you want to create your own backend because the processor you want to use is not there. It should be an easy task. It's not easy usually, but it should be relatively easy because you can do this all in Python. So to give an overview on how you can do this, you can encode instructions via tokens. So, which instruction are we going to encode? I will show it. It's an x86 instruction. We want to create a Python class for it that can encode this instruction. Does anyone know what this instruction is? It's the x86 interrupt instruction. So with CD05, we call interrupt 5 on an Intel CPU. So let's encode that in Python. So here we saw that it consists of two parts, CD and 05. So it contains an opcode token and a byte token. So in this cell, I defined the two opcode tokens. It's 8 bits, and it contains an opcode field. And the second one has a value field. Next, we include from the encoding, we include instruction, operand, and syntax. And you can define the instruction, the interrupt instruction. I called it like that. It has an operand, a number, and a syntax. So the syntax is int and then the number. And the tokens are the ones just specified. And then there's this patterns action here, which maps the values to fields. And then what you can do is you can create this instruction by calling the constructor and passing the number. And then if you call encode, you see the CD005. And also you see here, this is the string representation, and it takes the syntax from there, and then you see the textual representation. And you can also do the reverse, so you can also, it also has a decode function, so if you have some data, you can decode instruction again from this data. All right, I'm over time, so we go on. So some opportunities or ideas what you possibly could do with this. Maybe you can combine SIMPy and PPCI and generate some code from that. There is also a preprocessor work in progress which you might use with PyC Parser. Or you can write extension module maybe in C3 language, which is also here, instead of needing a Visual Studio or GCC or LLVM installation on the target machine to make the extension modules more easier to port. And that's it. Thank you.
Are there any questions? Oh, the back.
Thanks for your talk. It's a very nice little project. Now, let's imagine someone wanted to give a course on Cython and people have problems installing a C compiler on their laptop. Would that help? Like, how capable is it? Can it actually compile all of C, or are there limits to that currently? Or
Yeah, so purely hypothetical, right? Yeah. No, but... No, it's at the moment it's not possible. So the target is the C90 subset of C, or what is it? C89, C90, that thing. But it is not. It's still a work in progress. So the add example that I showed, that works, but it remains to be further developed.
Are there any more questions?
One.
Sorry.
Porting, as you're supporting currently some of the microprocessor architectures, is it possible to also link it to MicroPython or something that you can compile C code and run it on a microprocessor, let's say?
Yes, so there is support for the Extensa instruction that is, I think, for the ESP82 chip, that is the extension or the instruction set they use. And but what is the micro? There's also IRM support, so that is for, I think, some MicroPython board. But I don't know how you would do that actually.
Okay, thanks.
But you have to see.
So that's everybody, I guess. Okay, thank you very much.